Dear students, welcome to the third lecture on the subject English literature. The theme of our lecture is Literature of the Medieval Period. Objectives. By the end of the lecture, students should be able to do the following: to examine different areas of life in medieval England, to analyze the impact of changes during the Norman conquest, and to understand the significance of folklore in England during the medieval time. During the lecture, we will discuss the following questions. The first one, characteristics of the medieval period. The second, Norman England. And the last one, early English and Scottish ballads. The early portion of the medieval period in England is dominated by Anglo-Saxons, whose language is incomprehensible to today's speakers of English. That early portion is known as the Old English period. The Old English period came to an end with the Norman invasion of 1066. Normans spoke a dialect of French later called Anglo-Norman. The invasion put French-speaking people at the highest levels of society. Families that ruled England also ruled and held land in France. William the Conqueror was also Duke of Normandy, and the English king continued to hold that office and its lands until the 13th literary selections from various centuries will give you a very rough idea of the wide variety of literature circulating in medieval England. At one time, the medieval ages were known as the Dark Ages, a label which suggests that they were represented blank pages in the history of Western civilization, but a closer look shows that there were many accomplishments during this time in history. During this period, many important features of our modern world were born, including parliamentary, government, common law, present-day languages, and modern nation-states. In art, it was a great period for bookmaking, architectural rivalry, and a time of important developments in sculpture. Here given the characteristics of Middle Ages. Focus on religion, war and violence, invasions, oaths and pledges between vassals, feudalism, local lords have economic, military and social political power, and the Roman Catholic Church has a lot of power. Much of the early literature of this period consists of sermons, prayers, lives of saints and homilies. In secure medieval literature, the figure of King Arthur, an ancient British hero, attracted the attention and imagination of these early writers. Arthur first appeared in literature in Latin history of the British kings around 1147. The majority of books from the Middle Ages were written in what is known as Middle English, though French and Latin were also used for law and the church respectively. Books were often made by monks, and it was a time and labor-intensive process. Everything was done by hand, making books very expensive to produce. So even a medieval London merchant could read a personal library of handmade books would have been out of his price range. However, as the middle class grew and literacy expanded in the later Middle Ages, people might have owned a book of hours, produced by professional artisans and copiers. Norman conquest had a considerable effect on the English literature. Before this period, English literature was mainly characterized by homilies, religious verses, translation of psalms, parts of the Bibles, lives of the saints, rules for an honest religious life, and prayers. This period was also known as the period of such new genre as fable and fabula.
Fables were short stories with animals for characters and conveying a moral. Fabula was a short funny story with men, people, cunning, sly, stupid husband, and unfaithful wives. The Normans who conquered England were originally members of the same stock as the Danes, who had harried and conquered it in the preceding centuries. The ancestors of both were bands of Baltic and North Sea pirates who merely happened to emigrate in different directions, and a little further back the Normans were close cousins in the general Germanic family of the Anglo-Saxons themselves. The exploits of this whole race of Norse sea kings make one of the most remarkable chapters in the history of medieval Europe. In the 9th and 10th centuries, the mercilessly ravage of the coasts not only of the West, but of all Europe from the Rhine to the Adriatic. They settled Ireland and Greenland and discovered America. They established themselves as the ruling aristocracy in Russia and as the imperial bodyguard and chief bulwark of the Byzantine Empire at Constantinople. And in the 11th century, they conquered southern Italy and Sicily, whence in the First Crusade they pressed on with the unabated vigor to Asia Minor. Those bands of them with whom we are here concerned and who became known distinctively as Normans fastened themselves as settlers early in the 11th century on the northern shore of France, and in return for their acceptance of Christianity and acknowledgement of the nominal feudal sovereignty of the French king were recognized as rightful possessors of the large province which thus came to bear the name of Normandy. Here, by intermarriage with the native women, they rapidly developed into a race which, while retaining all their original courage and enterprise, took on also, together with the French language, the French intellectual brilliancy and flexibility, and in manners became the chief exponent of medieval chivalry. Largely to the 15th century, however, belong those of the English and Scottish popular ballads, which the accidents of time have not succeeded in destroying. We have already considered the theory of the communal origin of this kind of poetry in the remote prehistoric past, and have seen that the ballads continued to flourish vigorously down to the later periods of civilization. With still existing English and Scottish ballads are mostly, no doubt, the work of individual authors of the 15th and 16th centuries, but nonetheless they express the little changing mind and emotions of the great body of the common people who had been singing and repeating ballads for so many thousand years. Really essentially popular too in spirit are the more pretentious poems of the wandering professional minstrels, which have been handed down along with the others, just as the minstrels were accustomed to recite both sort indiscriminately. The production of genuine popular ballads began to wane in the 15th century when the printing press gave circulation to the output of cheap London writers and substituted reading for the verbal memory by which the ballads had been transmitted. Portions, as it were, of a half mysterious and almost sacred traditions. In language and literature, the most general immediate result of the conquest was to make of England a triangle country where Latin, French, and Anglo-Saxon were spoken separately side by side. With Latin, the tongue of the church and of scholars, the Normans were much more familiar than the Saxon pirates had been, and in the introduction of the richer Latin culture resulted, in the later half of the 12th century, at the court of the Henry II, in a brilliant outburst of Latin literature. In England, as well as in the rest of Western Europe, Latin long continued to be the language of religious and learned writing down to the 16th century or even later. French, the dialect of which was spoken by the Normans, Anglo-French, it has naturally come to be called, was of course introduced by the conquest as the language of the governing and upper social class. And in also during the next 3 or 4 centuries, a considerable body of literature was produced. Anglo-Saxon, which we may know term English, remained inevitably as the language of the subject race, but their literature was at the first crushed down into insignificance. It mustn't be supposed, notwithstanding, that the Normans, however much they despised the English language and literature, made any effort to destroy it. On the other hand, gradual union of the two languages was no less inevitable than that of the races themselves. From the very first, the need of communication with their subjects must have rendered it necessary for the Normans to acquire some knowledge of the English language. And the children of mixed parentage, of course, learned it from their mothers. The use of French continued in the upper strata of society, in the few children's schools that existed, and in the low courts for something like 3 centuries, maintaining itself so long partly because French was then the polite language of Western Europe. But the dead pressure of English was increasingly strong, and by the end of the 14th century and the Church's life, French had chiefly given way to it even at court. As we have already implied, however, the English which triumphed was in fact English French English, was enabled to triumph, partly because it had now largely absorbed the French. During the period after the Norman conquest, culture was its height. Tales in lyrical poems appeared. They praised the gallantry, bravery of noble knights, the heroic deeds and their attitude towards ladies. These works were written at first in Norman French, and many stories came from old French sources. The language was a romantic dialect, so the genre was called romances. Later in England, such works were called the art of minstrelsy. The number of romances was based on Celtic legends about the King Arthur and his knights of the Round Table. The main characters of this genre, unlike the characters of Church, were not saints, but human beings. The worship of fair ladies motivated the plot of these stories. King Arthur was a historical figure, the national hero of Celts. He was described as an ideal king possessing all virtues of a hero. He was honest, wise, fair to all his vassals. They had their meetings at a round table which Arthur built for their feasts, so that all of them should be equal. Constantly, this notion has come to our days. Folk songs and ballads. Folk poetry, especially ballads, enriched English literature. Largely to the 15th century, however, belong those of English and Scottish popular ballads, which the accidents of time have not succeeded in destroying. We have already considered the theory of the communal origin of this kind of poetry in the remote prehistoric past, and have seen that the ballads continued to flourish vigorously down to the later periods of civilization. The still existing English and Scottish ballads are mostly, no doubt, the work of individual authors of the 15th and 16th centuries, but nonetheless they express the little changing mind and emotions of the great body of the common people who had been singing and repeating ballads for so many thousand years. Really, essentially popular too, in spirit are the most pretentious poems of the wandering professional minstrels, which have been handed down along with the others, just as the minstrels were accustomed to recite both sort indiscriminately. The production of genuine popular ballads began to wane in the 15th century when the printing press gave circulation to the output of cheap London writers, and substituted reading for the verbal memory by which the ballads had been transmitted,
portions, as it were, of a half-mysterious and almost sacred traditions. The folk poetry flourished in England and Scotland at the end of the 14th and the beginning of the 15th century. A folk song is a short poem in rhyme stanzas, usually set to melody. One of the varieties and the most interesting of folk poetry were the ballads. Ballads were for singing or reciting. Very often they were also for dancing. Ballads can be classified into three groups. The first, historical, were based on a historical event or fact. The second, heroic, were about people who were persecuted by the law or by their own families, but they made heroic deeds. And the last is romantic or lyric, described mainly love. Among the most popular heroic ballads were those about Robin Hood, who was an outlaw, 40 ballads about his relations with enemies, with his merry men. This is the end of our third lecture. Here in this very slide, you can see the revision questions according to the lecture. Here in this slide, you can introduce with a glossary in the terms of the lecture. Here, given the literature for further reading.